Welcome back. In our final segment today, we're going to talk about some solutions, some ways of dealing with issues of language that hopefully you can use on a regular basis and will find helpful. We really want to think about using language that respects people as equals, that doesn't put anyone in a demeaning or patronizing kind of a role. And I've got a couple of guest speakers who will share with you their unique perspectives on this concept of referring to them as a person rather than as their disability. So let me turn to our guest speakers for a moment, and then I'll pick right back up.
People have referred to them as episodes, or, you know, have they got your, you know, spells under control? That is very incorrect. You know, medically they're called seizures, and that's offensive anyway, just to say your episodes. It sounds, you know, like, it sounds like I'm having a temper tantrum when it's something I physically can't control. So, or, you know, your spells, it's like, I'm not a magician. I can't turn these things on and off. So, and just, yeah, epileptic for me, you know, I am not epileptic. I have epilepsy, but it doesn't define who I am as a person. So I'd prefer to just be known as Stacy. You know, I'm a college student. I, you know, want to do better things after college. I'm not just epileptic, so.
So as you heard from our guest speakers, it's an interesting idea, isn't it, that they find that people tend to relate to them primarily based on their disability, whereas, you know, from their standpoint, their disability is just one aspect of who they are, and so there's that kind of tiresomeness of, why am I simply referred to as, you know, that blind girl, or that, you know, epileptic, or whatever it might be, when in fact, that's just an aspect. And in recognition of that, the American Psychological Association, the Associated Press, the number of journalism schools have adopted what's called person-first language. And again, this may seem rather political correctness, but what it does is it changes the emphasis. I've told you about my stepson. He's a wonderful young man. Love him dearly. He's probably one of the most helpful, cooperative people I've ever met. Loves trains, works 3 days a week, volunteers twice a week. He has autism. And we do worry about his future, but, you know, that's just part of how it works. Versus, if I talk to you about my autistic stepson. Big difference, isn't there? If I talk about my autistic stepson, that draws all of your attention to his autism, when in fact, he has so many more things about him than just his autism. That's what we're talking about here. But also, when I mention this kind of language, recognize that insiders, people who have disabilities, this is not meant to say you should or should not refer to yourself in a particular fashion, but for people who aren't you, who are outsiders, who are trying simply to make sure that we're respectful, using person-first language is a highly recommended thing to do.
Language is important to me in the sense that when it is being discussed on a mass scale, like if you're writing an article about visual impairment for the Northern Star, you would say, a person who has a visual impairment or who is blind, not a blind person, because people will see that all over campus and all over the community. And when you're talking to me, if you're one of my friends, I make blind jokes all the time, and my friends do, and it's just the way that we communicate. And people within our community, blind community, you're a blink or you're a squint, you know, whatever. We call ourselves all kinds of things, but it's the way that we're allowed to use those terms, because there are terms. The general public, people interacting with you, need to be more cognizant of the terminology they use, because sometimes it can be very demeaning and very dehumanizing. And some people like me will get in your face and say, no, thank you, that's not what you do. Some people will not.
Person-first language, I think it's important, but I'm not gonna be, I don't think I shouldn't be like the language police, and I don't want to make people nervous and say, oh, well, you said the wrong word, you must not like me, you know. But I think it does, language that you use does reflect how you see someone, and so I think language can be important. I am a person with a disability. But I also think it's important to recognize that I do have a disability, because it's important for me to plan appropriately. I'm going to need more things, more accommodations, for example, for if I were to do a job, or I'm going to need to do a particular kind of job. I'm not going to be doing hard labor. So I think that's important. I'm going to be using my brain more than anything. So
it's the idea that you put the person before the disability. So if I have to talk about it, it's my stepson who has autism versus my autistic stepson. We also try to use expressions that are fairly neutral. So we don't say afflicted from, suffers from, victimized by. This person simply has a disability. It's nothing that needs to be catastrophized.
I'm not suffering from my blindness. I don't like it when people tell me, oh, well, you know, she is suffering from being visually impaired. That's not the case for me. I don't suffer from anything related to blindness.
So if you think about this, let me give you a couple of examples here real quick. Right? Look at this. The blind experience high unemployment rates. How might that be changed using this concept? The blind experience high unemployment rates. People who are blind experience high unemployment rates. Better phrasing. Or she is confined to a wheelchair. How might you say that differently? Because again, confined to a wheelchair, pretty negative image. How about she uses a wheelchair? Neutral, non-judgmental, no negative implications. Same thing, he suffers from diabetes, he has diabetes. I've got two references posted for you that I think you might find particularly helpful to learn more about this. One is from the University of Kansas. It's a document called Reporting and Writing About People with Disabilities. And then there's another very excellent site at Syracuse University entitled Guide to Disability Language and Empowerment that hits all of these topics in more depth, and particularly the website at Syracuse provides lots of references for how this topic has evolved over time as a way of relating to people. And again, I'm being very simplistic here. There are many people who can make finer distinctions in the medical field, World Health Organization, but as we think about it for this class, I want you to make the distinction very clear between disability and handicap. And how we'll make that distinction is the disability is an attribute. It is something that the person experiences. So for my brother, it's his deafness. For my stepson, it's his autism. For our guest speaker, Sheila, it's a spinal cord injury, right? That's the disability. The handicap, however, is not unique to disability. Handicap is simply another word for a barrier. So we'll talk about handicaps more later on as it relates to topics upcoming, but handicaps can be technological, you know, where you can't get on the website, for example. They can be attitudinal, where I don't want to interact with the person. They can be architectural, where there's no ramp or there's stairs. But, you know, lots of ways in which, you know, we find barriers. We'll end with this. Not everyone listening to this MOOC has a disability. I know that. But everyone who is participating in this MOOC can, however, be handicapped, if you will, given a situation. And I'm going to give you a quick example. All right, now, if you happen to know sign language, American Sign Language, you probably understood what I said, which was something along the lines of, hey, you know, I'm signing here, gosh, these other people out here, if they're not understanding me, really, who's the handicapped one? It's you who don't understand, because if I were communicating with another deaf person, there's no handicap, there's no barrier. If you're part of that conversation and don't know sign, however, the handicap rests with you, not with us.
When I hear the word handicap, oh, I really strike high. The word handicap is offensive to me as the word, the N word. You know, handicap, the C word, which I have a hard time saying, cripple. And there are people still who would refer to your presence as so-and-so is crippled. Oh, they got a crippled daughter. They have a crippled son. Or if a person is hearing impaired, they still say deaf and dumb, you know. But for a person with mobility issues, it's, you know, if they use that word cripple, they use either cripple or handicap. And I hate to hear that. And, you know, I hear that language in my community.
So as we look forward to next week and summarizing, you know, today's lesson, the points I would like to reiterate as a summary, language has power. It affects our attitudes. It affects how we think about things. That people are more than just their disability. So disability is an aspect of who they are. It doesn't define them. That the media oftentimes look at disability and use it to evoke emotions in ways that aren't necessarily helpful for people at large. And that things that we can think of doing as a future-oriented or solution kind of focus would be to make sure that we focus on accessibility, both from a caption standpoint, video description standpoint, technological standpoint, and also that when we use language to talk and write, that we use disability-related language that puts the person first and doesn't place any judgment on the condition. So with that, we'll close for today, and looking forward to next week, where we talk about stereotypes and attitudes. Thank you.